What's up, y'all? Welcome back to Fish the Moment. In this video, I'm gonna help you identify 6 different types of cover on your down imaging. So let's get into it. Before we start identifying different types of cover on down imaging, you want to make sure that you have a basic grasp of what this down imaging image is showing you. You want to know where this image is in relation to your boat, where the bottom of the lake is, where the surface of the water is, and what it means to see something in this black space on your down imaging. And if you don't know the answer to all those questions, I would highly recommend checking out my beginner's guide to down imaging. It'll explain all the basics that you need to know that will help you better understand what I'm talking about in this video. I'll link that video down in the description, check it out, and then come straight back to this video. So assuming you have a basic understanding of down imaging, I want to discuss one specific element of down imaging that's going to help us differentiate different types of cover, and it's something that's not covered in that many videos. And that's identifying the hardness of the bottom or the hardness of an object based on how bright or dark an object is on the screen. So if you spend any time graphing around with your down imaging on your Fishfinder, you've probably noticed that certain objects are brighter than other objects, and certain parts of the bottom might be brighter than other parts as well. And the brighter an object is, or the brighter the bottom is on your down imaging, the harder the bottom will be. And the reason that harder bottom areas will be brighter on your Fishfinder than softer bottom areas has to do with the strength of the return when the sonar beam is sent out from your transducer to the bottom of the lake and then bounces back up to the transducer. And if you don't know what I mean when I say the sonar pings from the transducer to the bottom of the lake and back up to the transducer, I would highly recommend going and checking out that beginner's guide to down imaging I mentioned at the beginning of the video. It will make all the content from this point forward make a lot more sense, and it's crucial to understand the basics before we get into identifying different types of cover on your down imaging. So assuming this all makes sense so far, basically what happens is that when that sonar beam is sent from the transducer to the bottom of the lake and then bounces off the bottom, when it bounces off hard bottom areas, it's going to have a stronger return and therefore show up as a brighter image on the screen. And then when it bounces off a softer bottom area, it will give a weaker return because that bottom is softer and absorbs some of that sonar beam energy, and it's going to send back a weaker return, which is going to be darker on your down imaging. Therefore, you can determine how hard the bottom or an object is in the water by looking at how bright the object is on your down imaging screen. And this is super important when identifying the different types of cover on down imaging, because each type of cover is going to have a different return strength and therefore is going to have a different brightness on your screen. And if I was going to rank the different types of cover by the strength of their return based on the material they're made out of, I would say that rock is going to have a very strong return, along with metal and shell. So those are going to be the brightest objects on your screen. Next, you would have your newer wood. So a tree that had just been dropped in the lake, or trees that had just been flooded, so they may have only been in the water for, let's say, less than a year. And then after that, you're going to have trees that have been in the water for, let's say, 2 to 5 years. They'll start to decay after that point, and their signal strength won't be as strong. And I would say that grass has about the same strength of return as a brush pile that's been in the water for 2 to 5 years, so they'll be equally as bright. And then you'll have brush piles or standing timber that have been in the lake for 10 plus years. And a lot of times these trees don't have a very strong return. And a lot of times you can actually find that fish will have a stronger return than these really old trees and brush piles. And so there are certain ways you can identify fish in trees by playing with your sensitivity and settings to take advantage of the weak returns from the trees and the strong returns from the fish to see fish in the trees. And we'll talk about that later in this video. And I'm sure that many of you are wondering what settings I'm using in my Fishfinder to differentiate the different brightness levels on my screen. And I'm not actually going to talk about that in this video. I've actually already made a video about Fishfinder settings and how to get the proper settings on your Fishfinder regardless of the brand of unit you're using or the model. So check out that video if you're interested in understanding how to set up your Fishfinder settings properly. But without further ado, let's jump into identifying 6 different types of cover on your down imaging. Number 1. Rock piles. So rock piles are going to come in all different shapes and sizes on your down imaging. And sometimes you're going to have rock piles that are very small, and the rocks may only be the size of a softball. And then sometimes you might have giant boulders that are the size of a pickup truck. And so let me explain how you can identify all the different types of rock piles and distinguish them from maybe just the bottom of the lake or other types of cover. first, let's start with the most obvious type of rock pile, which is an area with big boulders or really big rocks. Usually these images are gonna be pretty easy to identify on a Fishfinder because they're going to look like a pile of rocks or a big boulder. But one way you can make sure that you're identifying rocks as opposed to maybe just a high spot on the bottom or a tree or anything else that could be down there is how bright the top of the object is. As I explained earlier, harder bottom areas are going to have stronger returns and the screen's gonna look brighter where you have those hard bottom areas. And so usually rocks are going to have a very bright return, especially at the top of the object. And a lot of times you can see a pretty big difference between the rocks in terms of how bright they are compared to a flat stretch of bottom that may be made of mud or clay. And this is the main way I identify rocks in my down imaging. I'm just looking for an object that's a lot brighter than the surrounding area or surrounding objects. And this way of identifying rocks works not only for the bigger boulders, but also the smaller softball size rocks, chunk rock, things like that. And if you take a look at some chunk rock in this image, you can see that the top of these rocks are very bright. And that's going to indicate that we're dealing with hard bottom, which is usually gonna be rock. Now, I don't know what type of rock it is. It also could be concrete or some other type of hard bottom area. But most of the time when you see this on your graph, it's going to be rock. And even if it is some other type of hard bottom area, it's still going to be a great place that will attract crawfish, bait fish, and fish. So I'd fish it anyways, even if it's not actually rock, but it'll definitely still hold fish.
Number two, brush piles.
The next type of cover we're gonna identify are brush piles. And a brush pile is basically a tree that someone has dropped in the middle of the lake. And on a lot of the bigger brush piles, it's pretty easy to tell that you're looking at a tree on your down imaging, because you'll be able to see the limbs and the branches of that tree, as well as the base of that tree, as long as your sensitivity is set correctly. Again, watch that video I mentioned earlier if you want to get your sensitivity right. And the main way I differentiate brush piles from other types of cover is by looking for black spaces or black areas in the middle of the object. If you take a look at this brush pile here, you can see that there's actually a black space right here, which is basically the gap between two limbs of a tree. And if you're looking at a rock, you're not going to see these black spaces because there's going to be solid rock there. And so any place where you see that black space again is just going to be water. It means there's nothing in that space. It's empty. There's no wood, rock, anything there. If that black space is there, it means it's just empty water. And so anytime that you see these black spaces in an object, it means there's just gaps in that object. And usually you won't see that in a rock or some other type of hard cover. It's usually going to be a brush pile because there's gonna be gaps in the limbs of those trees. But one common mistake I see a lot of anglers making is confusing bait fish for brush piles. And this is a mistake I used to make all the time when I started to graph offshore. And it's actually pretty easy to see why you might misidentify a big ball of bait fish for a brush pile, because sometimes you'll have these balls of bait fish that are close to the bottom, and if they're densely packed in, you'll have kind of a solid object, but they'll also have holes in these schools of bait fish where the bait are kind of swimming away from each other, or maybe they're not as tightly packed together. And so, like the brush piles I showed you before, you can actually have black spaces in the middle of these bait balls, which sometimes can actually look like a brush pile. But there's actually a way that you can easily differentiate bait fish from brush. And one of those is just by looking for those solid limbs that are sticking out and have a straight line. You're never gonna have really these like straight defined lines in a bait ball. And another thing to look for is that usually brush piles are going to be the brightest at the base of the object, or the base of that brush pile where it connects with the ground. That's usually where you have the stump or the log that holds all the branches of the brush. But a bait ball will usually have the brightest area in the center of that circle or that cloud. And usually that's where the most bait fish are gonna stay, is right in the center of that bait ball. And so the outside edges of that bait ball are going to be less bright. They'll be a little bit darker and a little bit hard to see on the graph. And so usually if your object has brighter returns at the base of the object and then weaker returns going up towards the top, that's going to be a brush pile. And then if your object has really strong returns in the center of that object and then the outside edges are a little bit weaker returns, that's going to be a bait ball. And really quick, guys, I want to remind you that I'm putting out a lot of new map breakdowns on my website, fishthemoment.com. These map breakdowns give you 60 spots with descriptions, the best conditions of fish each spot, as well as the best baits to use in each area. And these breakdowns are done by Randy Blockett, who is a bass fishing tour professional with $1.9 million in career earnings and a lot of tour wins. And we're putting out 4 maps a week on the website, and we added several more this week, and we'll continue to every single week. And so if you do want to be informed about which lakes we're breaking down and get notifications about when these maps come out, follow me on social media. I have a Facebook page, @FishTheMoment, and an Instagram page, also @FishTheMoment. And I'll post every single week when we post these maps. And I also have a lot of other great content coming to my social media pages, like Facebook Lives, Instagram Stories, as well as some articles and blogs I'll be posting on my website. And I don't have that many followers on my social media pages just because I don't really use them that much, but I plan on posting on there every single day going forward. So if you haven't followed me on social media, then definitely check out the links in the description below this video, or just go to my website, fishthemoment.com, and all my links are there. So definitely follow me if you want to get better at bass fishing and learn how to catch more fish this year. Number 3, stumps. The next type of cover we're going to look at are stumps. And stumps are one of the hardest types of cover to identify on your fish finder, especially using your down imaging, because they can look very similar to rocks if you don't know what you're looking for. So here's an image of some stumps that are sitting on the bottom. And right away, you might wonder, well, isn't that just a rock? It looks like a rock. It looks like all the rocks you're showing me earlier. And how do you know that that's a stump that's made of wood as opposed to a rock that's, well, made of rock? And really, there's only one easy way to identify which type of cover you're looking at on your down imaging. There's easier ways in the side imaging, which I'll get into in a separate video, but right now we're focused on down imaging, and that's by looking at how bright the object is. In general, you'll find that stumps are gonna have a weaker return or be darker than rocks. And that's because the wood that the stumps are made out of is softer than rock. And so if you look at a stump and a rock side by side, like in this image, you'll see that the stump has a weaker return, or it's a little bit darker on the screen than the rock here that has a brighter return. And usually you're going to see with a stump that you're not going to have a bright return at the top of the object like you will with a rock. That's because the top of that stump is not actually going to be that hard. It's made of kind of dying, decaying wood. And so one easy way to determine if you're looking at a stump or rock is to see if the top of that object is bright relative to the surrounding area. It's probably a rock. And then if the top of the object is not that bright and kind of the same brightness as the surrounding area or even a little bit darker, that's usually a stump. And another way that you can ensure that you're looking at a stump versus a rock is actually to take your sensitivity down. And when you crank your sensitivity down, what you'll see is that those rocks will still show up pretty much at the same brightness level as the bottom of the lake, but those stumps will pretty much disappear. And that's because when you take that sensitivity down, all of the softer objects will basically not show up on the screen because they don't produce a strong enough return to even show up. But those rocks will still show up because they have that strong return, and you'll still be able to see those rocks along with the bottom of the lake, where those stumps will be completely gone and all you'll see is the bottom of the lake when the object is a stump. But really, at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter if you're looking at a stump or a rock. What you're really looking for is an object that has fish around it. And so, for example, here is a great image of a stump that's surrounded by several dots and bait fish. This is an area where I caught some really good pre-spawn largemouth bass, and this is the type of area I'm looking for. And it doesn't matter in this image if you're looking at a stump or a rock, but sometimes it is good to differentiate the two if you're on a pattern where maybe the fish are on stumps really well, but they're not on rocks. But that's a very specific pattern, and that's something that comes up very rarely. So a lot of times it's not that big of a deal, but it's probably not gonna hurt to learn how to differentiate them. Number 4, logs. The next type of cover we're gonna identify are logs. And this is one of the trickiest types of cover to identify with down imaging. And usually I will use side imaging first to locate logs, then go over the top of them with down imaging to see if there's fish around them. But you can pick out logs on down imaging by looking for long stumps. And that kind of sounds silly, but that's basically what a log is, just a longer stump on the bottom. And you're gonna use the same rules you use to identify stumps versus rocks, except for these logs, instead of being maybe a quarter to a half inch thick on your screen, they might be a full inch to an inch and a half long. And this will tell you that you're looking at a log as opposed to a stump. Now again, it's not that big of a deal if you're fishing stumps, logs, or rocks. As long as there's fish on each piece of cover, that's what you're looking for. But sometimes, again, those fish will be on logs specifically, and this is what logs will look like on your down imaging. But 98% of the time when I'm fishing logs, I use side imaging to find them first, and then I will regraph over them with down imaging to see if there's fish around that log. And as I mentioned earlier, I am going to be making a complete video on how to identify the different types of cover on side imaging as well, and actually compare the down imaging image to the side imaging image so you guys get a full understanding of what these types of cover look like. So be looking out for that video coming out next week. Number 5, standing timber. The next type of cover we're going to look at is standing timber. And a lot of lakes around the country have standing timber, which is basically just old trees that were in the lake before it was flooded. And some lakes have varying degrees of standing timber. Sometimes it will stick up out of the water and go all the way up to the bank. Sometimes the standing timber was cut down and is only, let's say, 30 feet and deeper on your lake. And standing timber can be a great place to find a lot of good bass offshore. And it's usually pretty easy to identify standing timber on your down imaging because it just looks like a bunch of trees sticking them off the bottom. And when in doubt, just look for these straight lines that have black space between them. That's your standing timber. And so standing timber is usually gonna be pretty densely populated, and it can be hard to identify bass and bait fish around the trees. So one tip I can give you when graphing offshore around standing timber is take your sensitivity down a little bit. And usually when you do this, fish will actually pop and be a little bit brighter than the surrounding trees, because those trees are gonna be underwater for years and they're gonna be made out of softer material than fish. So when you take your sensitivity down, the fish are gonna look like bright dots among lots of vertical faded lines. And those vertical faded lines are the trees, because those trees, again, have a weaker return than the fish. And so you'll have dark trees next to bright dots. And I find a lot of big schools of fish suspended around standing timber that other guys miss because their sensitivity is set too high, and all those dots will blend in with those trees. If sensitivity is cranked up too much, everything is going to be bright on the screen, including the trees. But by taking that sensitivity down, you'll be able to differentiate the levels of brightness in the objects and make those fish pop out. And so that is my number one tip for fishing standing timber. Take your sensitivity down and then just graph around and look for these dots suspended in the trees, and you're going to get on a lot of good fish. Number 6, grass or weeds. The next type of cover we're going to look at is grass or weeds. And grass can be anything from milfoil grass, hydrilla, coontail, you have water willow grass, all kinds of different grass that will show up on down imaging. And in a lot of the recordings I'm showing you here, I'm looking at hydrilla grass because that's what I have in the south. But depending on which part of the country you're in, the type of grass will be different, but it will look very similar on your down imaging unit. So if I had to describe what grass looks like on down imaging, I would say that it looks like tall shag carpet. That's pretty much the best I got. But you can see in this image that you'll see these small little stalks or lines that stick straight up in the air. And usually this grass is going to grow in a way that the blades of grass are vertical and pointing towards the surface of the water. And grass will look different depending on how deep the water is and how tall the grass is. And sometimes you'll have grass growing out as deep as 20 feet of water, and other times it may not grow deeper than 5 feet of water. And so in this image, you'll see that the grass is in about 13 feet of water, and it's 4 or 5 feet tall. This actually leaves some black space between the top of the grass and the top of the screen, and that's going to be the water between the top of the grass and the surface of the lake. But if we take a look at another image, you can see that the grass in this image is growing a lot shallower, and it stops basically when it hits 7 or 8 feet of water. And this is what I would consider the outside grass line or the outside grass edge. And this grass pretty much tops out right at the surface. There's no black space between the grass and the top of the screen. And that's really all there is to identifying grass on down imaging. And really all I use down imaging for when I'm trying to find grass is looking for the grass edge, either the outside or the inside edge. The rest of the time I'm using my side imaging to look for holes in the grass, as well as ditches and other types of irregularities. And again, I'll get into that in another video. So guys, that's it for this video. Hopefully it helped you get a better understanding of your down imaging and will help you differentiate different types of cover when you're on the lake. And as I mentioned earlier in this video, I will be making a follow-up video where I'll explain how to identify different types of cover on your side imaging, and I'll actually compare the down imaging and side imaging images to make sure that it all comes together and makes sense for you. So again, thanks for checking out the video. If you enjoyed, share it out with a friend who may also be struggling with their down imaging and may need some help as well. So thanks again, and I'll see y'all in the next one.